help you.
Yeah.
So good evening to all of you. I'm Shantanu. Pajji was host for the evening program under Let's Talk Talk program. Today we have gathered to have discussion on a case-based approach on the management of acute atrial fibrillations. I welcome Dr. Sudhakar Rao, who is the chief organizer of this program. And for presentation and discussion on the topic, I welcome our esteemed speaker for the day. We have with us Dr. Manish Rai, cardiac electrophysiologist, KMC Hospital, Bangalore. I am sure this unique platform where evidence meet experience will help all to enrich their knowledge during this, even during these COVID times. Being the host of this program, let me brief some important aspect of this program. All participants to please keep their mics muted except the panelists. This is to avoid background noise. And if you have any question to ask, please use the chat option and send it to us. We shall present in front of the panel members for answering. You can send your question anytime during the presentation. So I welcome you all again and request our speaker, Dr. Rai, to proceed further. Dr. Rai, please.
Yeah. Hi, Shantanu. Thank you so much. Thank you, Sudhakar, for this opportunity again. This one, just one doubt. Can we have some participants participating in this? If I ask questions, is it possible for them to answer, to give an answer with it? Raise their hand or something like that. Sudhakar, is that possible?
Yes, sir.
Sir, they can unmute themselves or you can ask questions, sir. Yeah, they can raise their hand also. There is no issue.
Yeah, anyone who's interested to answer can unmute, right?
Yeah, yeah. That option is already there, sir. Anybody can unmute themselves and can ask question or give answer.
I think it's better that way. You know, that will make it interactive rather than making monotonous that I speak, you know, I finish it. So we'll stop. It's a case-based approach. So good evening, everybody. So I'll be talking on a case-based approach to management of acute atrial fibrillation. So we'll be concentrating mainly on acute atrial fibrillation, not on the long-term management of atrial fibrillation, etc. So this is going to be more practical oriented. How do you approach a case of atrial fibrillation in the emergency or in the OPD? How do you plan his acute management? What do you plan for the patient? So it's going to be very little about drugs and very little about theory. It's more of a practical approach. And I'm going to present 5 cases of atrial fibrillation in different scenarios. So what I would suggest is, you know, I'll put forth the cases. So if one of, I assume most of you are DNBs and, you know, this one who are DM cardiologists are in training or MDs. So, you know, I would really appreciate if someone could, you know, answer the question. So one of you can take up one question and answer, and let's see how you would approach. And then let's discuss as, you know, how else can it be approached? And, you know, what would be the other options for approaching this case? Okay, so I think that would be better. So, you know, so let's start with the case-based approach to atrial fibrillation. So management of AF, acute management of AF rests with 2 things. First and most important is whether you want to restore rhythm or rate. In most cases, you would want to restore rhythm. And the second is whether you want to anticoagulate the patient or not. So if you can take a decision on do these 2 things for your patient, as whether you want to achieve immediate rate control or rhythm control, or you want to achieve an immediate rate control and later on elective rhythm control, or would you want to achieve an immediate rhythm control, you know? So that would be one question that's running in your mind. The second question would be whether you need to anticoagulate this patient and for how long would you need to anticoagulate this patient. Third thing would be if you are planning a rhythm control, how urgent it is and what drug to use, or whether you use electrical cardioversion. So the entire management of AF revolves around these 3 things. If you can answer these 3 questions, so you know whether rhythm control is immediate or not. Second, how to approach rhythm control with pharmacological or electrical, and what pharmacological drug would you use. And third, whether you need to anticoagulate the patient or not. If you can answer these 3 questions, you'll do the right thing for your patient. Okay, so we'll approach the same in the cases in the same manner, trying to address these 3 concerns. Okay, so case number 1, a 40-year-old gentleman, no comorbidities, presents to the OPD with history of palpitation since morning. So he's a young man, absolutely no comorbidities. He comes to the OPD with palpitations since morning. This is his first episode of palpitation. His heart is structurally normal. So what, and this is his ECG. So this is his ECG. So an ECG taken reveals an atrial fibrillation with a slightly fast rate. This would be considered as a controlled rate. Anything between 110 and less than 60 and between 60 and 110 is a controlled rate. So you would consider this as a controlled rate. So this here you have a 40-year-old gentleman who's just coming to your OPD with palpitations. He's absolutely stable otherwise. He's just noticed some irregular heartbeat and he's anxious and he comes to your OPD. You take an ECG, there's an atrial fibrillation. His heart is absolutely normal. What do you do? Anyone?
Beta blockers, sir.
This is Sudhakar, is it? Hello? Anyone? Just introduce yourself. Just introduce yourself. Who is this?
Yeah, Dr. Narendra Kulkarni.
Okay, just Narendra, just introduce yourself. And just go ahead.
Yeah, Dr.
Sir, we can give beta blockers.
Okay, so what you would want to do for this patient? Just give beta blockers and leave.
Cardioversion.
Hello.
First.
Yeah. One of you, madam. Yeah. Tell me, madam.
First, I have to see whether patient is hemodynamically stable or not.
Hemodynamically stable.
To find out how long the patient is having, and second, I have to see whether patient is how long the patient is in atrial fibrillation. Then I have to do one echocardiogram to see rate control to exclude any clot in the LA.
Okay, then
after finding all these, if any structural heart disease is present or not. Now I will decide whether patient need, I will go for the rhythm control or the rate control.
Okay.
So if it is less than 48 hours of duration and if I have not found any clot, then I will go for the rhythm control. If the patient is hemodynamically unstable, then I have to go for the DC cardioversion. And if patient is hemodynamically stable, then I will go for either amiodarone or ibulite.
Okay, yeah, that's fine. Very good marks, you know, this one for theory. But tell me, for this patient, what would you do? This is a 40-year-old gentleman who's come with atrial fibrillation since morning. So, you know, and his heart is normal. So what will you do for him?
Cardioversion.
Then I will go for the rhythm control by I think amiodarone.
Okay, one option is amiodarone. Okay, someone else said cardioversion. Who said cardioversion? How many of you in favor of cardioversion? Lot of you in favor of cardioversion.
Medical cardioversion.
Medical cardioversion with what drug? Ibutilide. So someone would want to give ibutilide. Then what are the other options?
Ibutilide.
Okay, fantastic. So someone wants to give amiodarone, someone wants to give ibutilide. Then anything else?
Hello, sir.
Introduce yourself, please.
I'm Dr. Harnish Bhatia from SMS Medical College, Jaipur. Since this is a young male who's very stable without any structural heart disease and completely stable, I would rather go for rate control with either calcium channel blocker or beta blocker or digoxin and wait for it to cardioverse, as it has been observed that most of these rhythms, they cardioverse themselves by 48 to 72 hours. So I'll follow him up on OPD basis and ask him to come back. I put him on calcium channel blockers or beta blocker and ask him to come back on follow up.
Fantastic. Very good. Okay. So this is the point I wanted to make. You know, so these were the options I wanted to give you all. So would you consider IV amiodarone, ibutilide, beta blockade, or flaconide or beta blockade? So Dr. Harnish has made a very valid point that, you know, if you see most atrial fibrillation episodes, especially paroxysmal atrial fibrillation episodes, most of them undergo spontaneous cardioversion. So if you wait for 24 hours, you know, they're as good as a drug. So, you know, if there's a new onset AF in front of you, imagine you're in the ICU, there's a patient, you know, who's thrown AF in front of you, new onset, less than 1 hour, 2 hour, he's unlikely to spontaneously cardioverse. And if that AF throws him off balance, if he becomes breathless, hypotensive, or you know, if he goes into pulmonary edema, you need to bring him back to sinus rhythm. In which case, if you give a drug, drug works very well in conversion of acute AF, new onset AF of less than few hours, you know, much better than placebo. So, you know, and especially drugs like 1C drugs or amiodarone, even you can use a 1C drug also, immediate cardioversion is much better. But if you wait longer, if you wait for 24 hours, there's a good chance that this patient will come back to sinus rhythm on his own. Most, that's why they're called as paroxysmal AF. They can come to sinus rhythm within 7 days on their own without doing anything. The chances of coming to sinus rhythm is very high in the first 24 hours. So, you know, at 24 hours, if you compare, placebo is slightly inferior to drugs. So, you know, if you give something like amiodarone, you would have a 60% chance of conversion. But there's a good 50% chance of conversion. This patient will come back to sinus rhythm on his own without any drugs. So, you know, and I would wait for up to 7 days. That's the definition of paroxysmal AF in a stable patient. Like in the patient I told you, he's got absolutely no symptoms. He's just come to the OPD with palpitations. He's not having any, you know, he's not having any breathlessness. He's not having any giddiness, nothing like that. He's genetically stable. His heart rate is well under control. So, and he's got a normal heart. So, he's not going to deteriorate very rapidly. He's totally asymptomatic. So, there's no urgency in treating atrial fibrillation. Just because the patient has developed atrial fibrillation, there's no urgency. You have to see the clinical situation. If the clinical situation demands urgency, act wisely. Act urgently. But if the clinical situation doesn't demand any urgency, then you can wait for natural history. And natural history of spontaneous, you know, paroxysmal AF, especially first episode, is it will terminate on its own. So you can do nothing for 7 days. But do nothing would be, you know, the patient won't be happy with you. The other good thing would be to increase the conversion chances. So what I would do is put him on flaconide and beta blockade. So, you know, one option is to put him on beta blockade alone. But beta blockade would just control the rate, wouldn't, you know, the chance of rhythm control would be just as good as placebo. But I would just increase his chances of spontaneous conversion without having to be getting admitted. So what I would do is I would put him on flaconide and then beta blockade. So, you know, flaconide is a good drug, you know, 1C drug for, you know, spontaneous conversion, especially in paroxysmal AF. So many of the times in people with paroxysmal AF, we just give them pill in the pocket. So if, you know, a patient with a known paroxysmal AF, if he's got AF once in 6 months, once in a year, and he's got a normal heart, he comes to my OPD and says, or he calls me and tells me, sir, I'm having palpitations in today morning. I just say, pop in 2 tablets of flaconide, 100 mg, and he'll be okay. So usually that converts him to sinus rhythm in a good number of cases. But usually it's not wise to give flaconide alone. Usually combine it with the beta blockade or a calcium channel blockade, because sometimes what happens is flaconide is an antiarrhythmic. It slows down atrial conduction. It can organize an atrial fibrillation into a flutter. So this patient who's come with an atrial fibrillation on flaconide alone can transform into a flutter. And flutters are faster. If you see AF patients, they're not very, very fast rhythms. But, you know, flutters are faster rhythms. So once this patient happens to go into a flutter, his rate could go to 140, 150, and it would be symptomatic. So, you know, that's why we don't give flaconide alone, but I would rather prefer a combination of flaconide plus beta blockade. So I would do exactly what Dr. Harmesh suggested. You know, I would just reassure him, give him flaconide and beta blockade, you know, or just beta blockade also, maybe, but, you know, and then ask him to come after 1 week and tell him that this has got a good likelihood of spontaneous conversion in 1 week's time. If it doesn't convert into 1 week's time, then we'll have to cardiovert him. So we'll have to bring him back to sinus rhythm, either medically, or, you know, with the pharmacological cardioversion or with electrical cardioversion. So that's the strategy I would do for an absolutely stable patient with a new onset atrial fibrillation of a very short duration, less than 24 hours. So generally, if the patient comes to me after 3 days or 4 days, I would be skeptical, because now his conversion chances are less. So I would rather say that we may have to convert you. But if he's just come with atrial fibrillation, which started in the morning, I would be in absolutely no hurry, especially if he's stable. So, you know, things would be different if he's come with a longer duration. You know, the chances of conversion is maximum in the first 24 hours, can go up to 7 days. Okay, so it's always a good decision to do nothing sometimes for the patient. Just wait and watch for spontaneous conversion. So that's the first point I wanted to make. You know, every AF need not be treated urgently and need not be urgently cardioverted. So you can wait for spontaneous cardioversion in a good number of patients, especially in paroxysmal AF. First detected AF, someone comes with atrial fibrillation, lone atrial fibrillation, you know, he's got normal heart, he just comes with palpitation of, you know, 6 hours, 8 hours. You can wait on him. Just put him on antiarrhythmic, send him home, ask him to come on follow-up after 1 week's time. And, you know, if he doesn't come back in sinus rhythm in 1 week's time, then you have to bring him back to sinus rhythm. Okay? Now, second thing is, Dr. Harmesh, can you answer this question? Or if someone else wants, they can take this question. Risk of stroke in paroxysmal atrial fibrillation is less than that of persistent and permanent atrial fibrillation, chronic atrial fibrillation. Hence, paroxysmal atrial fibrillation doesn't need anticoagulation. Is this statement true or false? the stroke risk in paroxysmal AF is less than that of persistent AF or chronic AF. So paroxysmal AF doesn't need anticoagulation. Is this true or false? Anyone?
Dr. Suhail, yes, sir.
Yes, Suhail, tell me.
It's false, sir.
Why?
Because it's not just the electrical abnormality in AF that leads to the stroke risk. It's also the return of atrial functioning after having stasis for some time that can dislodge a clot and push it into the peripheral circulation.
That's a very good point. So, you know, but what the point I'm trying to do here, trying to, you know, drive home here is, you know, the risk of stroke doesn't depend upon the type of AF.
Duration of AF.
Many patients with, you know, paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, you know, just a few minutes of atrial fibrillation, but multiple episodes, can have clots and suddenly can they can throw a stroke. And you know, the stroke doesn't depend upon the type of AF. Although patients with permanent atrial fibrillation or chronic atrial fibrillation with structurally abnormal heart definitely have a higher risk, like mitral stenosis or something like that, or LV dysfunction. But otherwise, by and large, it's not decided by the type of AF. It's decided by the Chadwick score. So the stroke risk is purely determined by a Chadwick score. So any patient, even a paroxysmal AF patient, if he's got a high Chadwick score, needs anticoagulation, no doubt. So coming to the same question, what about this patient? You know, he's a 40-year-old gentleman, you know, who's got no risk factors, but he's come with atrial fibrillation. Would you anticoagulate him or not?
40-year-old male, no other risk factors.
I'm Narendra, sir. His CHAD score is zero, sir. So no need of anticoagulation.
Okay. Anyone else? Everyone agree with that point?
So his score is one, sir. He's a male sex. But for males, actually, this score is more than or equal to 3.
Okay, what would you do? What would you want to do? You would want to anticoagulate him or not?
No, sir. Definitely, there is no indication of anticoagulation in this patient.
Okay. Then, anyone else?
Anyway, since we are expecting spontaneous cardioversion, I don't think there is a role. Unless it does not cardiovert on follow-up, then probably would give anticoagulation. But right now, it does not need any.
Okay.
I have a doubt about whether you would... anticoagulate this gentleman if he comes back after 1 week of having AF continuously and then you plan to cardiovert him. Because Suhail.
Okay, we'll leave this as an open-ended question. We'll see if I answer your question later on, okay?
Yes, sir. Can I add one more thing?
Yeah.
Actually, in this patient, like we told, actually, if we are planning for the actually cardioversion, if the patient doesn't have got spontaneous cardioversion even after 1 week, when he has gone into actually persistent cardioversion, in that case, when you are planning, then we have to go for the classical anticoagulation course of 3 weeks prior that and followed by 4 weeks after that without any indication of long-term anticoagulation.
Very good point. I mean, I don't completely agree, but that's a very good point. I'll make that point later on. Okay, I'll clarify that point. What's your name?
Dr. Jay Prasad, sir.
Jay?
Jay Prasad.
From where are you?
I'm from Bangalore, sir.
Bangalore. That's a very good point. I'll clarify that point later. Okay.
Right.
So point number two, risk of embolic events, I already told this, is decided by the Chadwick score, not by the type of AF. So this is another thing that needs to be driven home. So many people have the, you know, wrong notion that patients with paroxysmal AF are at a low risk of, you know, stroke and they don't need anticoagulation. Only patients with persistent AF, permanent AF need anticoagulation. That's not true. The stroke risk, long-term stroke risk is decided by the Chadwick score, long-term stroke risk, okay? So it's purely decided by the Chadwick score. Okay, now we'll go to case number two. 55-year-old, obese, hypertensive, comes with worsening breathlessness, you know, since 10 days. He's in NYHA class 2 since 10 days. On examination, he's found to have atrial fibrillation with rapid rates. Rapid rates means 120 to 130. He's hemodynamically stable. No failure. PICO is normal heart. So what will you do? What's your plan? So this is another interesting thing that many patients with atrial fibrillation don't actually present with palpitation. They can present with failure. They can present with worsening dyspnea, effort intolerance. In this patient, because he's obese, hypertensive, some diastolic dysfunction, his breathlessness would be because of rapid rates and loss of atrial kick. So in any symptomatic patient, it's very, very important to bring him back to sinus rhythm. Okay, so in asymptomatic patient, you can wait. And, you know, lots of studies say that, you know, sinus rhythm, restoring rhythm or rate is a totally different debate. You know, many studies say that they are equal on the long term. But from what we've seen, you know, from an electrological, physiological point of view, like my boss would say, you're born in sinus rhythm, it's always better to remain in sinus rhythm. You know, because, you know, sinus rhythm has its own benefits. So as electrophysiologists, whenever we see an AF, unless the atria is really big, really dilated, and we're sure that they can't maintain sinus rhythm, we always try and attempt sinus rhythm. So we'll try to maintain sinus rhythm for 6 months to 1 year. If it fails, then we'll call it permanent AF. But we'll not right away call him permanent AF and not do anything for him. That's wrong. I think it's always better to attempt, even in the worst case scenario, try to attempt sinus rhythm. Unless you're sure, it's a DCM, really huge atria, 6 centimeters, 7 centimeters, then might not be worth it. But anyway, in the borderline, I would give the benefit of doubt to the patient, try to restore sinus rhythm, try to maintain sinus rhythm and see how he feels on follow-up. Okay. So barring that, what would you do? What is the plan for this patient? So he comes with breathlessness of 10 days. So what is your strategy? What all would you do? So how would you consider those three points I told you in the beginning? Anyone?
So firstly, this patient is already symptomatic as he has already crossed more than 1 week of paroxysm. Are you able to hear me, sir?
Introduce yourself, please.
I'm Dr. Jayaprasad, sir.
Okay, tell me.
So now actually he has crossed more than 7 days. Now the paroxysmal AF has gone to persistent, and most importantly, the patient is symptomatic. So what ideally I would do is, first I would actually give the first dose of anticoagulation clexane, followed with go for a transesophageal echocardiography and rule out actually LA appendage clot. Already you told the echo is a structurally inhibiting. Followed by I will go for pharmacological cardioversion first. And if he doesn't respond to pharmacological cardioversion, followed by electrical cardioversion, and subsequently put him on actually anticoagulation for actually 4 more weeks.
Anyone else has different point of view? Anyone else? Anyone who would start him on amiodarone right away, anticoagulation plus amiodarone? Tell me what you would do in clinical practice if this patient comes. Anyone? Nobody else has got a different viewpoint?
Good evening, sir. Dr. Gaurav from Trichur.
From
Trichur.
Okay, Trichur. Yeah, tell me.
The first way, as the patient is having worsening breathlessness, so first we'll try to give a bolus amiodarone 150 stat in our ICU for 1 hour, and then we'll start with the anticoagulation also, sir. And we send a ABG and we see, find out what is the cause of the acute worsening. If the ABG is having potassium or any electrolyte abnormalities, we'll correct that also with that. Okay. And so what we will admit in the CCU, we'll give a stat amiodarone 150 with the anticoagulation, and then we'll follow up the patient how is behaving to our treatment.
Dr. Gaurav, this one amiodarone you're giving for rate control or rhythm control here?
No sir, we are trying to since patient is in breathlessness, and so better we'll go for rate control first.
Okay, now you start that, this is the common practice. Everyone does the same thing. I'm sure, whoever's keeping quiet also would agree that most of you would admit him in the ICU, give him clexane, anticoagulation, nobody of you would miss it. And it's a crime to miss anticoagulation in these patients, But all of you, I'm sure you would start him on amiodarone. No, that's the go-to drug for this patient. But I just want to know, what is the intent of starting amiodarone? Is it to restore rhythm or to control rate?
Sir, first the acute cause of rate, sir, I think more than 120, we'll try to get the rate control first.
Amiodarone is to control rhythm, sir.
Rhythm. Okay, fine. Let's see. So this is the point I made earlier again. So, at the longer the duration of AF, your class 1C drugs don't work very well. Similarly with ibutalide also. So, if you're using ibutalide, it's usually, ibutalide is best used for AF you see in front of you. So in ICU AF, in post-operative AF, when someone calls you, your intensivist or your intern calls you and tells you that there's an atrial fibrillation running since morning. So in such cases, you can use ibutalide. Longer duration of AF generally doesn't respond to ibutalide. So if there's one drug which you can use for acute conversion for a longer duration of AF, is definitely amiodarone. But then again, its utility decreases with the time passing by. But 24, 48 hours and all, it's good. 7 days might not be. But there's another point I want to make here, this one. So this is the, pharmacological versus electrical cardioversion. Pharmacological is not that effective for acute conversion. Electrical is much effective, especially in initial stages and all that. Unless if the heart is normal, electrical is almost 100% effective. So this one, and the downside of pharmacological is negative inotropy, proarrhythmia, time consuming. And this one, but the downside of electrical cardioversion is you need anesthesia, at least sedation. Okay. So in this patient, you would do rate controlling with drugs, beta blockade, or you know, this one, you know, amiodarone, maybe for rate control. So if this patient can't tolerate anything else, maybe I would give him a small bolus dose of amiodarone for rate control, but I would I refrain from it. My rate control strategy would be drugs like beta blockade or something like that. Start him on diuretic if he's in failure. Anticoagulation, absolutely must. And then consider cardioversion. So, you know, cardioversion, either pharmacological or electrical. So now, you know, with going with the majority, let's say you give pharmacological cardioversion with amiodarone. You give amiodarone. After 24 hours of amiodarone, he's in sinus rhythm. For your luck, after giving amiodarone bolus and infusion, he's in sinus rhythm. What next? What about anticoagulation? So now, you know, we'll just consider this. This is not the right thing to do, but assume that you have done this. This is the traditional practice. That's why I put it. You know, you would control rate, put anticoagulation, give amiodarone infusion for 24 hours. Most of you would do this. And after 24 hours, some of you would be lucky to see him in sinus rhythm. So what next? So what about anticoagulation in this gentleman? He's a 55-year-old, I think, you know, 55-year-old with, you know, hypertensive. That's all. So what about anticoagulation? Let's pick up the true statement. Anticoagulation in acute AF, this is not chronic AF, is decided by Chajwa score, not necessary after pharmacological cardioversion. Because you have cardioverted him pharmacologically, it might not be required. Embolic risk is lower in pharmacological cardioversion when compared to electrical cardioversion. Maximum risk of emboli is during the procedure, which is the true statement.
So, yes, sir, decided by Chajwa score.
Which one?
Decided by Chajwa score.
Can you contradict the other statements, why they are wrong?
Yeah, because after pharmacological cardioversion also, risk of embolism persists for up to 4 weeks after the cardioversion, both pharmacological and electrical.
Okay.
And risk of emboli during the procedure is not maximum. It is maximum after sinus rhythm is restored. Like I said earlier, because the return of atrial activity is when the emboli will dislodge and start moving around. So,
yes, good. But, you know, actually all four statements are false. Acute atrial fibrillation, you know, I mean, this is partly true. There are studies to say that people with low Chajwa score, even acute incidence of stroke is very less. But in general, you know, in acute atrial fibrillation, if you decide to bring the patient to sinus rhythm, that is cardioverting the patient, you know, you have a persistent AF. If you decide that, you know, you have to bring him back to sinus rhythm, either electrically or pharmacologically, you have to give him short-term anticoagulation. Short-term anticoagulation is not decided by anything. So any patient with, you know, you get my point again, any patient with persistent AF who you decide to cardiovert, either pharmacologically or electrically, you have to cover them up with anticoagulation for a minimum of 3 to 4 weeks. You know, so, you know, I'll explain this point later. The risk of stroke is the same with pharmacological and electrical cardioversion. The stroke doesn't occur during the procedure. Many have the misconception that stroke occurs during the procedure of electrical cardioversion. That's why they're more careful with electrical cardioversion. And you take pharmacological cardioversion blindly. So, you know, saying that no, pharmacological cardioversion is safe. It's not like that. Like someone explained, Sohail explains, stroke occurs when the atrial kick resumes. So what happens is, traditionally, when you convert an atrial fibrillation into sinus rhythm, so immediately after cardioversion, electrical or pharmacological, you will see P waves on the ECG. But that P waves on the ECG says that the atrial electrical activity is back. But if you put a Doppler across the mitral valve, or if you do an LA appendage study, the atrial appendage contraction wouldn't have returned. You would have P waves, electrical activity would have returned, but appendage contraction wouldn't have returned. The appendage contraction will return in the days to follow, maybe 3 days to 7 days to 14 days. When this time lag is there, during this time lag, if you don't cover with anticoagulation, you will have small clots formed within the LA appendage after sinus rhythm is restored. And when the appendage starts to contract, it will push off these clots. So the clots and the stroke is not because of the procedure per se, it's because of the atrial stunning. Stunned atria. So, you know, it's electrically normal, mechanically stunned, especially the LA appendage. So there's a disparity between electrical sinus rhythm and mechanical restoration of sinus rhythm. So if you put a Doppler across the mitral wall, or more importantly, if you study LA appendage. So, you know, it's in that days to follow, if you don't cover up with anticoagulation, you'll have small clots. And when the LA appendage continues to contract, it'll throw off the clots. So irrespective of how you bring this patient to sinus rhythm, whether pharmacologically or electrically, it doesn't matter. The stroke risk is the same. And the stroke risk is because the LA appendage is still not functionally normal. So you have to cover them up with anticoagulation for a minimum of 3 to 4 weeks. The reason for 3 to 4 weeks is the strokes are maximum during day 2 or day 3. This is where traditionally the LA appendage starts to come back to function normally. So during that day, during those days, you will have strokes. And this stroke risk is there for a minimum of 2 to 3 weeks. So generally what we say is cover them up for 3 to 4 weeks with short-term anticoagulation. This short-term anticoagulation is independent of the CHAdWise score. Irrespective of the CHAdWise score, if you're converting a patient to sinus rhythm, you have to cover them up with short-term anticoagulation. After 1 month, reassess the patient. Then you see his CHAdWise score. If his CHAdWise score is 0, you might not consider. Anything beyond 1, you would consider long-term anticoagulation. So the point I'm driving here is short-term anticoagulation is independent of the CHAdWise score. It is because, you know, irrespective, and it's independent of the type of cardioversion. It's independent of pharmacological or electrical cardioversion. It really doesn't depend. It depends because the LA appendage is still not contracting, even though sinus rhythm has been restored. And, you know, if you do not cover up with anticoagulation, there's a risk of clot formation. There are studies to say that short-term anticoagulation might not be required in patients with very, very low, you know, lower CHAdWise score, you know, of 0. But again, by and large, to be on the safer side, you know, and short-term anticoagulation doesn't do any harm. If the bleeding risk is low, it's better to err on the safer side and give everyone with, you know, anticoagulation, because the last thing you want is a stroke after a sinus rhythm. So that would be really devastating, you know, and these embolic strokes in atrial fibrillation are really bad because they are huge strokes. That's the last thing you would want to. So it's ideally, it's better even for paroxysmal AF also, you know, short term, if you have to convert him, if you're giving an antiarrhythmic, like in the previous case also, I would err on safety. I would say in the first case also, you know, a 40-year-old gentleman, I would cover him up with anticoagulation for the next 4 weeks, you know, and after 4 weeks, decide on his long-term anticoagulation. If he has no CHAdWise score, then I'll remove him of anticoagulation, then put him only on antiarrhythmics for a short duration, or else, you know, just put him on pill in the pocket strategy. But anytime I'm cardioverting a patient, either pharmacologically or electrically, it's always better to cover up with anticoagulation. So anticoagulation, atrial fibrillation, remember these points. Short-term anticoagulation for anyone who undergoes cardioversion, irrespective of the type of cardioversion. Long-term OAC decided by the CHAdWise score. Short-term anticoagulation for 3 to 4 weeks and then reassess. Embolic risk is maximum during the first week. So, you know, if you see that way, you, like Dr. Jayaprasad said, you have to do a TE before giving amiodarone. Okay, because imagine, you know, you have a patient and you're considering for anticoagulation, you're considering for cardioversion, you will not cardiovert him without a TE. So you will do a TE first, make sure that he has got no clot, and then only cardiovert him. Now, but amiodarone, we give left, right, and center, even without seeing the TE status, assuming. But what we have to understand is, amiodarone has the same stroke risk as cardioversion. So ideally, you know, many a times we do use amiodarone in acute setting. A patient comes with atrial fibrillation with rapid rates, especially ISD patient or heart failure patients. You can't give other drugs for rate control. That time you can give amiodarone for rate control. So you can give a bolus dose of amiodarone, maybe 100, 150 or 300 mg, just to bring down the rate, and better is failure. But you know, don't give amiodarone with an intent to convert sinus rhythm. If you're actually giving amiodarone with an intent to bring him back to sinus rhythm, you should actually do a TE to make sure there is no clot, and then give amiodarone continuous infusion to bring him back to sinus rhythm. So if you're giving amiodarone with an intent to just control his rate, that is fair enough. So, you know, what I would do in such patients is, like Dr. Jayaprasad said, I would just give him anticoagulation, control his rate with beta blockade. If his rate is too rapid, I would give him a small bolus dose of amiodarone just to bring it back to normal, to 100, 110. Make sure he's fine, he's lying supine, he's not orthopneic. Continue anticoagulation, do a TE the next day, and then cardiovert him. I wouldn't go with the pharmacological cardioversion. And, you know, even after TE, you're justified in trying amiodarone for 24 hours. But, you know, my choice is always electrical cardioversion, because I know it is completely safe, it's completely effective, and, you know, it allows me to study the underlying conduction system before venturing onto a drug. So I hope these points are clear. Anyone has any doubts in this case, second case?
Sir Sohail, yes, I have a couple of doubts. So one thing I just wanted to clarify. So suppose we put a patient on a pill in the pocket strategy, and he develops symptoms, say after 6 months, he develops symptoms and then takes his pill, say about 4 or 5 hours after he develops symptoms. At that point, should he anticoagulate again for another month or?
No. No, not required. If you have decided on a long-term strategy of no anticoagulation, it's not required. Paroxysmal episodes, no. But again, it's individualistic. But generally, no, they are safe. But if you're planning on a cardioversion, like, you know, you're admitting him and then cardioverting him, it's always better to cover up for short term. You can, you know, you can err on being the safer side and give him short term anticoagulation. I do it for some of my patients. Although, you know, these are subgroups which are not very well studied. But generally, by and large, paroxysmal atrial fibrillation with low Chad West score do not require anticoagulation. So you can just put him on pill in the pocket strategy and leave it. Okay.
So next question is that like you said, sir, often we get a call in the post-operative period after a patient has undergone surgery. In such patients, bleeding risk is usually higher. Hmm. So when we can't anticoagulate these patients, then what do we do? Should we not cardiovert the atrial fibrillation and keep him in AF but control the rate and then wait till he's okay for anticoagulation and then aim to cardio?
I have a discussion. My fifth case is on post-operative AF, so we'll wait for that.
And okay. one last thing, I think this one also you'll discuss that just with the emergency cardioversion. I'm sure you'll discuss that at some point.
No, so emergency cardioversion, I'm not going to discuss. What's your point?
Because we won't be able to look at TE in a patient.
No, pulmonary. Emergency cardioversion is done only in two situations. Either you have a pre-excited atrial fibrillation, very rapid atrial fibrillation, pre-excited atrial fibrillation, or you have an atrial fibrillation with a hemodynamic compromise. You have an atrial fibrillation in shock or something like that. Then it's an emergency. You don't look at stroke share. You don't look at stroke status. You just cardiovert him.
Yes.
But in the situation, there are only two.
Yeah.
Either the AF is causing hemodynamic compromise, which is very, very rare. So the other situation is a true emergency. It is a pre-excited atrial fibrillation. You have a WPW. He develops atrial fibrillation at a very rapid rate. You cardiovert him. You cardiovert him not for the AF, because if you don't control that rate and bring him back to sinus rhythm, that rate can stimulate the ventricle and result in a VF. So for that reason, you cardiovert him.
Okay? That is taken, sir. But in patients who have like DCM, for example, and if they come in pulmonary edema and just happen to be in AF at
the time. It's always better. It's in DCM, especially when the stroke risk is high. If you always venture onto rate control, TE and cardioversion. If you do a direct cardioversion, you'll end up with a stroke. Unless it's inevitable, do not cardiovert. Right. So, always try to make him go a limit, control his rate, and then do a TE and then cardiovert. Otherwise, you'll end up with sinus rhythm. But if he's had a stroke, what's the point?
Yes.
What's the point? Okay?
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, how far can we rely on the duration of onset of symptoms of less than 48 hours or greater than 48 hours in a patient with structurally normal heart and with the structurally abnormal?
No, I'll get to that point later, but you can't. Symptoms are not realistic, not reliable. I'll get to that point later. I'm going to make that point again, okay?
Sir, I have a question. Okay.
Yeah?
Yeah. Sir, Harinisha, I wanted to ask, in the previous case, a patient who had a paroxysmal AF and it got cardioverted with either electrical cardioversion or pharmacological cardioversion, even if he might have a Chad's VAS score which comes in the range of anticoagulation, do you think if it was just a paroxysmal AF and he would never have a recurrence, do you think he still requires, or a Holter might help in that case if you do a Holter and there's no evidence of any paroxysmal AF?
No, the thing is, once a paroxysmal AF, unless you have an explanation for the paroxysmal AF, if the patient had developed an atrial fibrillation in the ICU because of hypokalemia or in the course of a lung infection, pneumonia, and you're sure this AF is going to come back, then maybe you're justified to short-term anticoagulate, reassess his risk, and decide on long-term anticoagulation. But if it's an unexplained first episode paroxysmal AF, and thyroid. So if it's an unexplained first episode paroxysmal AF and his stroke risk is high, you might not consider antiarrhythmic, but you have to consider him on anticoagulation. Holter monitoring will not help because, Holter for 24 hours, you're not going to have paroxysmal AF episodes every day. So, you need to, in stroke patients also, if you have a patient with an cryptogenic stroke or a stroke where you suspect an embolic episode, you're actually advisable to do a Holter for 30 days, not for one day. For 30 days to rule out paroxysmal AF. Okay, so a short-term Holter monitoring for 3 days or 7 days or, one day is not going to help at all. So you decide on long-term, you just see why he developed AF. If there is no explanation for his AF, and if he's elderly, if he's a low atrial fibrillation, if his Chad West score dictates, he requires lifelong anticoagulation, no doubt, even if it's a first episode. Okay, his second episode will come. It's only a matter of time. Okay, all right. So going to case number three. This one, 35-year-old lady, known case of moderate mitral stenosis, comes with palpitations and worsening breathlessness since 8 days. So ECG shows atrial fibrillation with slightly faster heart rate. ECHO you have done, it shows mitral stenosis, moderate mitral stenosis. LA size is not bad, 4.6. What will you do? Anyone? So we can have more interaction, new people. Yeah, anyone? Yes.
So this is Dr. Shreya here. Sir, we'll start the patient on anticoagulation based on INR reports.
Yes, then?
And then we'll overlap it with warfarin.
Okay.
Later on.
What will you do for his AF? I mean, for his rhythm?
For rhythm, we can start.
Yeah.
For first, we'll do the rate control.
Okay.
With beta blocker, and then later on, we can continue with the anticoagulation for lifetime.
So you don't want to restore sinus rhythm in him, in her?
If she continues to be symptomatic, only then.
She's already symptomatic, no? She's got moderate mitral stenosis.
Like after rate control, even if she's like, even after rate control, she's symptomatic, then maybe we can plan for rhythm.
Okay, fair enough. Fair enough. But one thing to remember is, Shreya, that, you know, see, this patient with structural heart disease, no? Patients with Wallner heart disease, patients with, you know, LV dysfunction, IHD, especially LV dysfunction, they don't tolerate AF very well. So, you know, for time being, they might be better. And, you know, two things. One is, you know, for time being, they might be better. Second, it's impossible to get very, very accurate rate control. On one day, your rate might be 70. Another day, it might be 120, 130. So, you know, rate control strategy is not absolute. In a patient with, you know, rate control strategy would be, you know, for an elderly patient, 80-year-old patient who's fine or something like that. Yes. But any patient with a structural heart disease, it's always better to see if you can restore sinus rhythm because the heart is already compromised. So, if you restore sinus rhythm, they'll feel much better. So, leaving them on rate control, initially with IV diuretics and all those things, they might feel better. But, you know, long term, they'll again become breathless. And, you know, unfortunately, what will happen is if you don't do anything now, after 6 months, if you see this patient, your LA size will be 5.6 because of the AF. And at that point, even if you cardiovert them, it will not help. So, you know, because, you know, AF will result in remodeling. So it's always better to give them an option or try once rhythm control. If that fails, then you can resolve, you know, rate control later. The bad thing is AF, if it goes untreated, it can result in atrial remodeling and atrial dilatation. And then it AF perpetuates AF. So then after 6 months, if you decide to cardiovert, it will not maintain sinus rhythm. So, you know, the earlier the smaller the atrial size, much better to maintain sinus rhythm. Okay? So that's a viewpoint. Anyway, this was my viewpoint. Anyone else? Anyone else?
Is it possible to maintain to have a persistent sinus rhythm with the LA diameter of 4.6?
You know, it might not be, you know, see, the thing is, in this patient, if you cardiovert them, if you bring them sinus rhythm, you might maintain sinus rhythm for a good 6 months to 1 year, which is very, very good control, which is a control you would achieve even with the pulmonary vein isolation. And the patient will be really happy. The next time he goes into sinus rhythm, he or she goes into sinus rhythm, they will ask for a cardioversion. Me or not, many mitral stenosis patients, many AF patients, the hardest thing is to convince them for the first cardioversion. But once you convince them for the first cardioversion and they see the benefit of sinus rhythm, the second cardioversion, which will happen, you know, in the eventuality after 6 months to 1 year, they will ask for it. You will have no problem convincing them at all because they would know the benefit of sinus rhythm. So even an 8 months control of sinus rhythm or then 1 year control of sinus rhythm is really worth it. And, you know, you should give the benefit. Because I told you, if you don't give the benefits, if you decide on permanent AF, calling this patient as permanent AF and treating them with medical management, you know, you're losing opportunity for life. Because after 6 months to 1 year, her LA size will be much bigger. And at that point of time, you can't do anything. So, you know, it's better that you do your best for the patient then and there. And see, in future, if you maintain sinus rhythm, fine. If it doesn't, and if he has a recurrence after, you know, 1 month, 2 months, or frequent recurrences, then you call them off as permanent atrial fibrillation and do the rest for them. Okay, so it's always better to maintain sinus rhythm. Okay.
Hello. Right.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yes.
So for this particular patient, she's symptomatic with atrial fibrillation for last 8 days. Hmm. So we should give adequate anticoagulation for 3 weeks before we consider cardioversion.
Hmm.
Then after, if it is reverted to sinus rhythm, should we like, we may have to give her antiarrhythmic therapy also.
Okay.
So that's what I'm asking, like after, if it is reverted, in other cases, we decide if according to the frequency of, like expected frequency of recurrence of AF to consider either daily antiarrhythmic therapy or atrial fibrillation with Wallner heart disease and there are chances of recurrence, should we consider consider her for daily antiarrhythmic therapy.
Yes,
if she is reverted to sinus rhythm.
So that is true. I'll come to the answer of this, but I disagree with one of your point that you would want to wait for 3 weeks with anticoagulation and then cardiovert her. See, the thing is, that's an option. I'm going to discuss that point, T and cardioversion. The guidelines do say that. There are two approaches to this patient. One approach is, you know, because it's more than 48 hours, you can follow the approach the doctor said, that anticoagulate for 3 weeks and then do a TE and then cardiovert. Or the other approach is do a TE, rule out a clot, and then cardiovert. You need not wait for 3 weeks. It's an early cardioversion approach, wherein, you know, in any patient who comes after 48 hours, you really need not wait for 3 weeks of anticoagulation. You can start on simultaneous anticoagulation, do a TE to rule out any clot. And in most cases, you will not find a clot. If you don't find a clot, cardiovert it then and there. You need not really wait for 3 weeks of time for anticoagulation. So although the guidelines do recommend that, in less than 48 hours, you can do no TE, anticoagulation and cardiovert. But irrespective of the duration of AF, for me, I told you, no, if it's a new onset AF of less than 24 hours, I will never attempt cardioversion. I will wait for spontaneous termination. But if, you know, and I would try to cardiovert any patient who's got an AF of more than 72 hours, 96 hours. So this question really doesn't arise for me. So, but if, unless it's a medical emergency, you know, in the ICU, and if it is that case, I know that, you know, I am sure about the duration of AF in the ICU, that yesterday night the patient was in sinus rhythm, today is in AF. I know the duration of AF. In such cases, I would not do a TE and I would just anticoagulate and cardioversion. But if I'm not sure about the duration of AF, if the patient's history is not adequate, or if I'm not sure of the duration of AF, I will always do a TE. Rule out a clot and then cardioid. And then another approach is, you know, really do not have to wait for 3 to 2 weeks to 4 weeks of anticoagulation before cardioversion. You can do an early TE. Start on anticoagulation, do an early TE, rule out a clot, and then cardioid. Okay. So in this patient, you would start anticoagulation, start rate controlling drugs, beta blocker, digoxin, you know, and then rhythm restoration. So rhythm restoration, first I would do a TE to rule out any clot, and then start on amiodarone bolus, and then cardioid. Okay, so, you know, there's a reason, you know, I wouldn't prefer, how many of you would prefer actually amiodarone infusion for this patient and, you know, before cardioversion? Ideally, what we do is we prime for cardioversion. So, you know, cardioversion works. But what happens sometimes is, you know, in patients with valvular heart disease and all that, you cardiovert the patient, they come back to sinus rhythm. But if you don't prime them with an antiarrhythmic, they can go back to AF immediately after cardioversion. That's an unfortunate thing. So sometimes it's a good idea to prime them for cardioversion. You can prime them for cardioversion with a small bolus dose of amiodarone. You can give them 150 mg of amiodarone, 300 mg of amiodarone after TE, after you made sure there is no clot, and then give a cardioversion. Okay, so in such cases, the cardioversion what you give will maintain. So, you know, the patient will maintain cardioversion, and then you can decide on long-term, antiarrhythmic therapy. Definitely in patient with structural heart disease or something like that, who the risk of recurrence is very high, you will require long-term antiarrhythmic therapy. So you would start something on flaconide or something. Patient along with long-term anticoagulation. There's no debate about long-term anticoagulation. There's no debate about long-term antiarrhythmic therapy. It's about anything. Now, what I would want to ask is, can someone tell me about cardioversion? Has anyone done cardioversion and how they do the cardioversion? Can we discuss something about cardioversion? How would you do a cardioversion for an atrial fibrillation? Anyone?
Synchronized DC shock with 50 joules.
Synchronized DC stop with 50 joules. Then?
Anterior posterior paddle position.
Okay, then?
If not, 50 doesn't work, then 100.
Okay, then?
200.
How many of you do that escalating dose of cardioversions? Many of you?
50 to 100 we do, sir.
Yeah, 50 to 100, yes.
Biphasic or monophasic?
Biphasic.
Okay, fine. So direct current cardioversion, no? I'll just tell you a few things about cardioversion. One is there are two types of shock waves. One is a monophasic wave. In monophasic wave, what happens is you have two paddles. One is, you know, this is anterolateral or anteroposterior. So here you have in monophasic, the waveform is in one direction. So from here to anode to cathode, whichever direction it is. In biphasic, it reverses. So half the waveform is in this, and half the shock vector reverses and goes in the opposite direction. So, you know, that's why if you see the curve, it's biphasic. So you have positive and suddenly it becomes negative. That means the shock waveform comes in one direction and midway it turns and goes in the opposite direction. This might be 50-50 or might be 60-40 or 70-30. That is called as a tilt. At which point it reverses is called as a tilt. So you can have a 50-50 reversal or you can have a 70-30 reversal or a 60-40 reversal. In most defibrillators, you can't change the tilt. But in implantable defibrillators, we can also change the tilt. That is one thing. So as you would see, biphasic waveforms are superior to monophasic waveforms. So presently, most defibrillators are biphasic defibrillators. And because they're superior, the amount of energy required in a biphasic is much lesser. So in monophasic, if you require 200 or 360, in a biphasic, you will require only 200 joules. Because it reverses the tilt, it shocks the tissue in both directions. Okay, so the energy required is much less. So generally, traditionally, now, we always have biphasic waveforms. Another important point in atrial fibrillation is always synchronized. So you synchronize to the peak of the R wave. So never do an unsynchronized shock, okay, or an asynchronous shock. If you do an asynchronous shock, the shock wave will fall on the T wave, vulnerable period, and can result in a VF. So asynchronous shock is only for a ventricular fibrillation, not otherwise. So you always do a synchronized shock. Regarding the amount of energy that you use, so there are studies to say that you can use 50 to 100. But generally, it is safe to use 100 to 200. I would, for us, it, you know, the amount of energy really doesn't matter. It doesn't cause harm to the tissue. But repeated shocks definitely does harm to the tissue. So imagine a situation, and it does harm to the patient also. Imagine a situation, you give a 50 joule shock, and then you give a 100 joule shock because it fails, and then you give a 200 joule shock. You're giving 3 shocks to the patient. He's not going to cooperate for the third shock. So better is you go either with 100 or 200. We routinely use 200 joules. The amount of shock doesn't actually damage the tissue. It's the repeated episodes of shock that damages this tissue and stuns the what LV function. Only thing you have to remember is in patients with real LV dysfunction, EF less than 15%, do not shock. So that's a contraindication for shocking. In a patient with a clot, pre-existing clot in the heart, either in the LA appendage or in the LV, do not shock. So these two things. So severe LV dysfunction and clot, do not shock. Otherwise, biphasic shock, synchronized shock with 200 joules or 100 joules if you want to in a normal heart, it's fine. Okay, fair enough. Paddle position, both are good. For atrial fibrillation in a structural heart disease, like in mitral stenosis and all those things, you can try anterior posterior. It is more effective than anterolateral positions. Okay, or sterno, this one, this position. But what we do is our shocking protocol is we try this paddle position, one shock. If it fails, then we can change the position. So, you know, that is what we do for repeated, you know, or failed cardioversions. So, you know, another important things during cardioversion are oxygen prior to cardioversion. So you need good sedation. Use a non-hypertensive agent, good sedation, give oxygen prior to cardioversion. During cardioversion, switch off the oxygen because otherwise it can result in a spark, you know, and suddenly you'll have a spark. Then use biphasic 200 joules, always synchronized. If your cardioversion fails, which can happen in a dilated heart or in mitral stenosis or with a big atria, so what you do is one option is amiodarone preloading. So you can load, you can give 150 mg of amiodarone. That's why we routinely give amiodarone preloading before cardioversion. So, you know, short amiodarone preloading to prime the, you can do it with ibutilide also. Change the paddle position. So you can reverse the paddle position. You can do anteroposterior paddle position. And third, look for metabolic derangement. Look for hypokalemia or acidosis, both of which will hamper cardioversion or maintenance of sinus rhythm. Okay. So this is about electrical cardioversion. Next, we'll go to case number 4. 75-year-old elderly gentleman, known case of DCM with severe LV dysfunction, new onset worsening of NYHA class because of atrial fibrillation. Duration of worsening is only 3 days. So he is hemodynamically stable, average heart rate of 130 beats per minute. What is the plan? So is a DCM with severe LV dysfunction, you know, 75-year-old, new onset AF of 3 days. So, you know, maybe 3 days. So he's hemodynamically stable, but you know, I told you, just like in structural heart disease, DCM is another substrate wherein you really want to restore sinus rhythm because, you know, if, you know, they're already, their hearts are weak, their LV dysfunction is there. So if you lose your atrial kick, they'll be really symptomatic. So you have to restore the atrial kick. And in this patient, because the symptoms are only 3 days, it's very likely that you can restore his atrial kick very soon. So how would you want to do it? Anyone? Anyone?
I would like to try with pharmacological cardioversion.
How is that?
Exclude a clot in the heart.
Okay.
Then just the way you told, and then consider amiodarone infusion. Okay. Because the patient is hemodynamically stable. And okay, there is severe LV dysfunction. I don't know the ejection fraction. Considering electrical cardioversion may be risky here.
Okay, fine. You know, his EF was 35%, but I would take your point. Okay, I think most of us would do the same thing. You know, if you think back, most of us in a clinical practice would do the same thing. You would start IV anticoagulation and you start rate control with beta blockade digoxin. Many times we use IV amiodarone for rate control also, just to control the rate, in especially in DCMs wherein you can't give other drugs. You give diuretics for failure. You do a TE to rule out an LA appendage and an LV clot, and then consider cardioversion. So either pharmacological or electrical cardioversion. My preferred choice is, I told you, unless the ejection fraction is less than 15 and really big heart, I would always go for direct current cardioversion. The reason being this. So in a patient who's had AF for 3 days, 5 days, 7 days, you really do not know his underlying rhythm. So sometimes what will happen is, if you give, especially if I'm okay with 150 mg or 300 mg amiodarone, but if you give 1 gram of amiodarone, 2 grams of amiodarone, just anticipating sinus rhythm, you might achieve sinus rhythm, but it's very common to have this thing. So, you know, you'll have sinus bradycardia, profound sinus bradycardia, because the sinus node is conked off, or you might have junctional escape, and then you'll have QT prolongation. So, you know, I'm not very comfortable giving a lot of amiodarone without knowing the underlying rhythm. So many of the times in elderly patients with DCM, wherein, you know, sinus node also might be compromised, especially in elderly, 78, 80 years or no, you know, they will have some intrinsic sinus node disease. So if you bombard them with loads of grams of amiodarone, just hoping for sinus rhythm, you will achieve sinus rhythm, but at the cost of sinus node dysfunction. So you'll have some junctional rhythm, you'll have some very low escape rate, you'll have some sinus bradycardia, and then many of these patients, you know, might warrant a pacemaker. So, you know, this thing can be completely unavoidable. And add to it the, you know, the problem of QT prolongation with amiodarone. So, you know, I always fear this thing. That's why I always, you know, try to give amiodarone or any other drug only after knowing what the sinus rhythm. So what I would do in this case is, you know, just control with rate control and, you know, maybe a bolus dose of amiodarone just to control his rate. Do a TE and cardiovert him first. So once you cardiovert him, you know his sinus rhythm. You take an ECG, you know his sinus rhythm, you know his PR interval, QRS duration, QT interval, and then decide. To prevent recurrence of atrial fibrillation, I would give him amiodarone in this case. So give him 1 gram of amiodarone or less than that. If I've already given some bolus, I would give him another 300 or 600 mg. And then that I would give him just to prevent recurrence of atrial fibrillation. So another thing you should realize is, amiodarone acutely for conversion of AF is not a great drug. The, you know, it will work in really acute onset AF, one, you know, less than few hours and all those things. Longer the duration of AF, amiodarone doesn't work very well. And sometimes it can take weeks to work. So, you know, really, you know, just loading the patient with grams and grams of amiodarone is not justified. So, you know, if the AF is really new onset, 1 or 2 hours, maybe it works. Most drugs will work. So, you know, but if it's longer, 3, 4, 5, 6 days and all this, many of them, it doesn't work. And downside of giving amiodarone without knowing the intrinsic rhythm is, maybe you'll end up with a sinus node dysfunction and, you know, you might have to do a early pacemaker for this patient. So it's always a good idea to cardiovert first and then see what's the other rhythm. So, you know, amiodarone, even slow IV, always diluted with 5% dextrose. So if you dilute it with the normal saline, it results in profound hypotension. It should be given very slow. You know, the rate of infusion should be really slow. Yeah, it has a long half-life. All of us know it can vary between 35 days to 125 days. So, you know, once you give amiodarone, it stays in the system for 4 half-lives. That it stays in the system for nearly a year. So next time, before giving amiodarone, remember that. It's going to stay in the system for nearly a year. You can't undo it. Many of the side effects of amiodarone, like sinus bradycardia, junctional rhythm, really can be undone. You know, it's not like beta blocker. You stop for 2 days and they're fine. You know, if they develop sinus node dysfunction or junctional rhythm, they'll end up on a pacemaker. So, you know, be very, very wary. Metabolism of amiodarone is still not clear. We still do not know how it's excreted. You know, there are theories to say that probably it's excreted by the gut cells, you know, just when the gut cells are shed, and no real metabolism as such. And it's got a wide range of toxicity. So it's not a very safe drug. You should use it for the really deserving cases, maybe LV dysfunction, where you can't do any other cause, or structural heart disease. I generally use amiodarone not for conversion. My utility of amiodarone for conversion is very, very less. I would rather use ibutilide or cardioversion. So, you know, but I would use amiodarone to prevent recurrences. That's a good drug to prevent recurrences, especially if it's a structural heart disease like LV dysfunction or, you know, mitral stenosis, wherein I know you need a more potent drug. And when you can't use, you know, flaconide or something like that, then I would use amiodarone. But otherwise, the, you know, utilization of amiodarone is very, very little. It's true that, you know, for acute control of AF, rate control of AF, sometimes when you can't use anything else, you use IV amiodarone. So antiarrhythmic pharmacology, I will not discuss this. So, you know, IV amiodarone, you know, 5 mg per kg bolus dose over 1 to 2 hours. Remember that very, very slowly. And ibutilide, again, 1 mg you can give. You can give a repeat 1 mg after 10 minutes. And in post-bypass surgery and LV dysfunction, you'll have to reduce the dose. Okay. So coming to the last case, then we'll stop. 65-year-old IHD.
And sir, in the previous case, you wrote that you'd give IV drugs to rate control initially before cardioversion. So yes. You wrote digoxin. Do you also use IV digoxin a lot? Or
No. Oral digoxin. Yes. So last case, 65-year-old
one question.
Cardioversion with digoxin is a good idea, sir.
Which one?
Cardioversion with digoxin, is it a good idea?
IV digoxin for cardioversion? No.
Patient is on digoxin and you want to go for DC cardioversion.
That's okay. Unless it's toxicity, it's okay. No problem. Okay. All right, then.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, one question I have, if the patient has got LA clot or LV clot, in that patient, AF with first ventricular rate is causing hemodynamic instability. So we should not give him electrical cardioversion at any cost.
Yes, true.
We should try only with pharmacological or cardioverse infusion. Sometimes the patient with LV dysfunction can have LV clot. And if that patient develops VT also, the same principle applies. Like we can't give cardioversion, electrical.
True. You can't give cardioversion. Okay. True. Okay?
Okay.
Any clot anywhere in the heart is a cardioversion. Okay? Okay. Case number 5. 65-year-old IHD develops AF after CABD surgery, day 2. Patient is comfortable. Underlying LV function is good. What next? So what will you do? So post-op AF. So, you know, surgeon has done a CABG. Day 2, you have an atrial fibrillation. Patient is comfortable. Surgeon is worried. What will you do? Anyone?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
I think if the patient is comfortable and it's a new onset AF, in this case, I would probably do a TE and try to cardiovert it and bring it back to sanitizer.
Look, why would you want a TE? Because it's just in front of you, no? It's day 2. So within 24 hours, LV function is good. So you know it's less than 24 hours.
Probably you can wait for spontaneous cardioversion.
Yeah. So, you know, that's another point. In atrial fibrillation in post-op settings, it's very, very common. And the incidence is around 40% after CABG, 50% after valve, and 60% after combined surgery. Peak incidence is on day 2 or day 3. And natural history is, you know, up to 80% will revert on its own within 24 hours. You really don't have to do anything. Especially if the rate is controlled, you really don't have to do anything. Just maximum, give them beta blockade or in this one, you know, and 14 to 30% will revert within 2 hours. Most, at discharge, most of them are in sinus rhythm. So, you know, you try to treat the underlying cause, why this patient has developed atrial fibrillation. The most common thing would be either because of inflammation, some pericarditis or something, or electrolyte disturbance. So try to correct that. Try to correct electrolyte disturbance. Try to withdraw the inotropes. They'll be on multiple inotropes. Withdraw the inotropes. Introduce beta blockade. They are protective, especially against pericarditis. So beta blockade. And amiodarone, there's a role only for irritation. See, post-op AF can be, especially in a cardiac surgery patient, post-op AF can be because of metabolic, can be because of inotropes, can be because of inflammation, pericardial inflammation. So if there's an inflammation, you're going to have again and again episodes of AF because there's something irritating. So in such cases, beta blockade and maybe amiodarone will help to prevent the inflammation, you know, to reduce the inflammation. But by and large, unless the patient is symptomatic with rapid heart rate causing hypertension, you generally don't want to treat them. Treat them with beta blockade plus or minus a small dose of amiodarone. Okay. But only thing you need to consider is if the AF persists for more than 48 hours, there's a risk of stroke, short-term risk of stroke. So give them anticoagulation for a long time and for 1 month, and then decide on a long-term or oral anticoagulation. If the AF really persists for less than 24 hours in a post-op setting, the risk of stroke is minimal. It's not there, you know, because it's happening in front of you. So you really don't need to anticoagulate them. But if it persists for 2 to 3 days and then reverts back to normal before discharge, then it's a good idea to anticoagulate them irrespective of the CHAD score and LV function for 1 month, and then reassess whether you need long-term anticoagulation. Okay. So managing post-op AF, let it be if it's not troubling. Introduce beta blockade, reduce inotropes, correct electrolytes, look for effusion, amiodarone for rate control mainly if needed, anticoagulation if it persists for more than 48 hours. Rhythm restoration only in hemodynamically unstable or worsening heart failure, and if electrolytes and inotropes are optimal. Agents, you can use ibutilide in these patients in post-op, or in amiodarone you can use, okay, for rhythm control. Ibutilide, I will not go into the details. Remember that potassium should be normal. That's why for acute AF that you see in the casualty, don't venture out with ibutilide unless knowing what's the potassium, because you know the risk of NSVT is around 8%. So always know the serum potassium levels before you're giving ibutilide. Preload them with magnesium, 1 to 2 grams, and monitor for 8 hours after sinus rhythm ensures or after you give ibutilide. Okay. So this is in a nutshell the acute management of atrial fibrillation. So if he's hemodynamically unstable or evidence of pre-exaltation, direct current cardioversion plus anticoagulation for short term. In the absence of hemodynamic instability or evidence of pre-exaltation, so if you can decide on rate control or rhythm control strategy. Generally, you tend to shift towards rhythm control strategy, and I give you my reasons why. So in rhythm control strategy, you always do a TE first, through load LA appendage cloth, start on anticoagulation, then decide on whether you want to give DCCV or pharmacological cardioversion. You don't start on pharmacological cardioversion first and anticoagulation. You do a TE. Because you have to treat pharmacological cardioversion if you're attempting the same way as electrical cardioversion. You wouldn't want to electrically cardiovert any patient with a clot. Same way, you wouldn't want to venture into pharmacological cardioversion in a patient with a pre-existing clot. He's going to throw a stroke. So if you're really wanting to cardiovert a patient, then do a TE. Then decide on whether you want to cardiovert him pharmacologically or electrically. My option would be prime them for electrical cardioversion with the small dose of antiarrhythmic, or you give electrical cardioversion, see the underlying rhythm, and then give pharmacological therapy to prevent recurrences. And don't forget to anticoagulate this patient for short term, for 4 weeks. After 4 weeks, reassess the need for long-term anticoagulation. So the take-home point would be atrial fibrillation acute management, no urgency in treating every AF. Most of them revert spontaneously. Remember, paroxysmal AFs may revert spontaneously. Pharmacological cardioversion has the same risk of embolic stroke as electrical cardioversion. TE before cardioversion is ideal. Do not forget short-term anticoagulation. Embolic events peak in the first 2 weeks after cardioversion. Decide on long-term anticoagulation based on the CHA2DS2-VAS score. Thank you. If you have any doubts, we'll answer. Otherwise, we're done.
Sir, I was wanting to ask one question. All those patients with the non-valvular atrial fibrillation, we decide on the anticoagulation, we decide on the basis of CHA2DS2-VAS score. But for valvular atrial fibrillation, we only have two criteria to start the patient on anticoagulation. One is the left atrial diameter and one is the atrial fibrillation existence. That is the only two criteria for valvular atrial fibrillation.
No, any patient with the valvular heart disease, you have to start on anticoagulation. Okay,
so irrespective whether atrial fibrillation is there or not.
Only if the patient, there's no role for prophylactic anticoagulation in valvular heart disease. In a patient with atrial fibrillation and and valvular heart disease, you have to, there's no question about CHA2DS2-VAS score. You have to start on anticoagulation. Just because the patient has valvular heart disease, no prophylactic.
Okay.
Sudhakar here.
Yeah. Excuse me, sir. Hello.
Hello. Manish sir, Sudhakar here.
Yeah, hi Sudhakar.
Sir, actually, this question leads me to one question. Like valvular, there are many cases with mild to moderate MS or mild AS. Valvular.
Yeah.
Can we still treat with treat them as drugs? With NOACs.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, Sudhakar. Indication for warfarin in valvular heart disease is in structural heart disease. Valvular heart disease only prosthetic valves. And, more than moderate mitral stenosis, only these two conditions. So even AS can be treated with NOACs, no problem. Only if you have more than moderate mitral stenosis or if you have prosthetic walls, you can't give NOACs. For any other valvular heart disease, mild MS, many of my patients, mild MS are taking NOACs, not necessarily valvular. They do not come under valvular heart disease or structural heart disease. They do not come under that. So only more than moderate MS or prosthetic walls. That's it. Okay?
Okay.
Thanks. I have a question.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, in case of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patient having atrial fibrillation, should we consider anticoagulation by default or should we rely on the score again? Same thing for restrictive cardiomyopathy.
It is based on individual thing, because in a young patient with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, you wouldn't venture. But in an elderly patient with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, if he's got other risk factors, definitely long-term anticoagulation. But in a really young patient, 20-year-old hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, risk of stroke is less. But if the HCM patient on follow-up develops LV dysfunction or if he's got other diabetes or something, definitely there's no doubt. If there is no CHA2DS2-VAS score, then it's in your court. Ball is in your court. You have to decide for the patient. These are subgroups which are not very well studied. So based on the duration of AF and the LA size, you can decide. If its LA size is normal or something, then you can probably keep him on follow-up. But if the LA size is really big and and mild LV dysfunction or something like that, then you can definitely try on a long-term anticoagulation. Okay. So
it's individualized approach if it is not warranting because of the score.
Yes, correct. In young patients, you can forget it. Okay.
Okay.
Sir, suppose if the patient is having some metabolic disorder, like so many patients with diabetic ketoacidosis, they come with atrial fibrillation also. So even then, we need to start them on short term, like 4 weeks anticoagulation.
if it lasts for more than 48 hours, if you are acute AF, if you are ICU AF, patient with pneumonia or diabetes or electrolyte disturbance develops atrial fibrillation, most of them are going to cardioid within 24 hours. But if they last for 48 hours, 72 hours or something like that, then if there's no contraindication, you can consider short-term anticoagulation for 1 month. Okay?
Okay. Sir, in brief, could you just tell us quickly how you go about selecting a NOAC for your patient if you're choosing NOAC for non-valvular AF? Which one would you prefer safety profile-wise, and in which, if any special situations require special one of the
potency-wise, all of them are good. The consideration would be, you know, the one thing that you remember is NOACs are taken for life, especially in atrial fibrillation. So if the patient is, you have a fixed duration of NOAC, like, you know, you have a DVT or something like that, you're giving only for 3 months or 6 months, then, you know, I wouldn't mind a costly NOAC also. I wouldn't mind rivaroxaban or apixaban or anything like that. But if you're trying for atrial fibrillation and you're convincing the patient for long-term, lifelong anticoagulation, then the cost is very, very important. And that's why most of our prescriptions to date are, you know, mainly dabigatran and favirin, because anyway, these patients are on multiple drugs, so why burden them with additional cost? That's why I prefer dabigatran. That's the only reason, you know, for atrial fibrillation. But if the patient is intolerant to dabigatran, which happens most of the time, sometimes, you know, gastric intolerance, then I switch over to Eliquis or rivaroxaban. But in certain subsets, I would just definitely prefer, you know, apixaban, like in elderly patients above 80 years or, you know, weight less than 60 kgs or renal failure, then you would definitely prefer, then I would prefer apixaban. And, you know, the same thing with, renal failure patients is either apixaban or rivaroxaban, because, you know, dabigatran, you have to use a smaller dose, not very well studied in stage 4 CKD. But otherwise, in routine run-of-the-mill patients who require NOACs, it would be dabigatran itself.
Thank you, sir.
There is one question on how long to continue flecainide after starting for paroxysmal AF, which reverted to sinus rhythm with flecainide.
Yeah, the thing is, very good. That depends upon the recurrences. So, is this Sudhakar, right? It depends upon the recurrences. So if your patient is paroxysmal AF, he comes with you, you start on flecainide, maintenance therapy, you wait, you gain flecainide for 3 months, 6 months. If he's got no recurrence in 3 months, 6 months, you can withdraw it off and then see for his next recurrence. If his next recurrence comes after 1 year, you can do pill in the pocket. But, you know, on flecainide, if he develops a recurrence, or after stopping flecainide, immediately if he develops a recurrence, you would require maintenance therapy. So generally what we do is, after an initial episode, at least for 3 months, give flecainide. And then see, you know, if he's comfortable, continue for another 3 months. And then after 3 to 6 months, start withdrawing flecainide for seeing his recurrence. If his recurrence is nowhere anytime in future, just advise the pill in the pocket. But if he has an early recurrence, he requires a maintenance therapy. Okay?
Sir, we see generally starting on digoxin, sir, for the case one scenario, sir, is it now recommended, sir, or many of the digoxin, old professors?
No. Digoxin should be used in two conditions, probably one in LV dysfunction, second in mitral stenosis. Mitral stenosis and rapid rates, no, there you are justified in putting digoxin. Otherwise, most patients we don't put on digoxin. Okay?
Okay, sir, thank you.
Sir, before we wrap up, I just want, in current scenario, which will be the group of patient you'll consider for ablation in atrial fibrillation?
Ablation in atrial fibrillation, pulmonary vein isolation, what we do is two subsets of patients. Sometimes young AF, you know, the atrial fibrillation in very young people, 20 years old, 30 years old, no, you will have atrial fibrillation. These are not the traditional lone atrial fibrillation that you get in elderly. It's usually pulmonary vein tachycardias. And in them, it is very good prognosis because one of the pulmonary veins will be firing. Unlike in lone atrial fibrillation or elderly atrial fibrillation, wherein all pulmonary veins have to be isolated, in young people with atrial, it's not uncommon to find very young people with atrial fibrillation and strokes. And they are very symptomatic. So in these patients, we say it's pulmonary vein tachycardia. You know a clear pulmonary vein trigger. If you go inside, you will find that one or two pulmonary veins are firing. So, you know, we just isolate those pulmonary veins. So that's definitely a subgroup I will take for ablation. Elderly patients that run of the mill atrial fibrillation, it's not paroxysmal AF. You know, if they go into persistent or recurrent episodes of paroxysmal AF, then I would not advise first line ablation for them, because ablation in atrial fibrillation in elderly is not curative. The success rate is around 60-70%. So, you know, I will try medical therapy to see when is the next recurrence. If on medical therapy with flecainide or something, if I can postpone a recurrence for 1 year, then I'm doing good with medical therapy only. But with medical therapy, if I have an early recurrence, you know, every second month or something like that, then definitely I'll advise paroxysmal AF patients. Okay.
Okay, sir. Yeah. Excuse me, sir.
Yeah. Tell me.
Sir, if a patient who is having severe aortic stenosis, sir, and then the preload is dependent on the LV left atrial contraction, in that patient, if he develops acute AF, what is the management strategy, sir? Like what we have to do? Should we wait for 24 hours so that we'll hope that the AF reverts on its own, or like should we go ahead because they are dependent on the left atrial kick, that 15 to 25%?
But it depends, you know, a severe aortic stenosis is another subset where you should be very careful while cardioversion. Anything which restarts the heart in severe aortic stenosis, pinpoint AS, you know, is going to be very dangerous. So in such cases, you'd rather err on pharmacological cardioversion, give them a try for rate control and pharmacological cardioversion. Because in aortic stenosis, severe aortic stenosis, anything that stops the heart, there's a good chance that the heart may not restart at all. So just like severe LV dysfunction, you know, so be very careful there. So in such cases, I would just venture into rate control and give them pharmacological cardioversion, try an attempt and reassess how bad it is. Okay. And in real severe aortic stenosis or something, it might be dangerous, double-edged sword, to give a cardioversion. Okay. You might be careful there.
Sir, you have discussed this, sir. Like I still have had a doubt in that. If a patient for the first time, like we see commonly in our situation, sir, severe MS coming with for the first time, with atrial fibrillation with rapid ventricular rate, and then when we look at the LA size, it is already dilated, sir. Like it is already five, more than five. So how do we go about? Like,
no, I will still attempt cardioversion. 5.5. I will still, I know cutoff is 5.5 PLAX view. So 5.5. I will still attempt cardioversion, restore sinus rhythm, see for the first recurrence. So give them a chance at sinus rhythm. See how long they tolerate sinus rhythm. If they tolerate sinus rhythm for 6 months to 1 year, I will again cardiovert them. But if they, you know, after you're giving cardioversion, next morning they're in AF again, or in 1 week's time they're back in first follow-up, they're back in AF, then you call them at permanent AF. So I will not write off a patient as permanent AF very easily, because, you know, sinus rhythm is very important for people. So I'll give an attempt at sinus rhythm. If it fails very early, then yes. Many times, you know, we've cardioverted people every 6 months, every 8 months and all those things. They do very well. They tolerate it very well. No problem. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Sir, I have a doubt, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, in a valvular heart disease, it is like an AF recurrence is more common. Hmm. So after reverting to sinus rhythm, we have to maintain him on anti-arrhythmic drugs. But yeah, long-term anti-arrhythmic drugs are not safe. So can we put him on rate control drugs after reverting to sinus rhythm?
Yeah, so you can pull off antiarrhythmics. So the thing is, some antiarrhythmics are safe even for the long term. Like flaconide and all are not toxic. It's amiodarone, which is toxic even for several years. So that is definitely there. So you can give, you know, you can give, one option is to give amiodarone for some time, for 6 months, 1 year, then pull off amiodarone and see for the next recurrence. Other option is to give him flaconide or something, and which can be continued for a really long time. Third option is just maintain them on beta blockage after you maintain sinus rhythm for 6 months. That's also not a bad option. Okay. So, you know, continuing amiodarone for a really long time, you should be wary. You should monitor the patient with LFT, pulmonary function test, and everything like that. So it's always better to switch off to a safer antiarrhythmic. A lot of them are there. Pradil, there is propofenone, flaconide, everything like that, which can be given for atrial fibrillation.
Okay. Thank you.
I think we'll wrap up. Hello?
Yeah. Yes, doctor.
I think we'll conclude here, sir.
Yes.
Yeah. Mr. Santanu. Yeah.
Hello, sir. Dr. Sudhakar, any concluding remarks from your end, sir? No,
yeah, you can.
You can. So, we are now towards concluding this wonderful program. I must say, this was an exciting program which has enabled us to gain from the wisdom and expertise of the speakers and panelists. I take this opportunity to thank Dr. Manish Rai and Dr. Sudhakar Rao for their great contribution in making this program possible and successful. I am thankful to all participants who have taken time out of their busy schedule to attend this program. I thank all of you for making this event successful, and I sincerely hope your support will remain with Torrent in times to come. So thank you, goodbye, and good night to all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr.
Rai. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sudhakar.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.